you doing?
Doing good.
Yeah. Awesome. Excellent. How is everybody up here doing?
Excellent.
Good.
Fantastic.
All right, wonderful.
Most excellent.
Let's jump right in.
Great.
Hello and welcome to the Most Excellent 80s Movies Podcast on the Most Excellent Podcast Network. It's the podcast where a filmmaker, a comedian, an actor, and an author strike out on a runaway mission to set the high score for revisiting the 80s movies we loved or might have missed with 2018 eyes. This is episode 17, The Wizard, a movie selection from 1989. Hit the trailer, Mr. Nate.
Just get the California, please.
That's $226.
Well, we only have $27.30. What does that get us?
Nowhere.
Corey's taking his brother Jimmy on a ride.
These two boys already traveled more than 80 miles across the state.
We hired someone to find him.
What's his problem? He's just shy.
But Jimmy's got a secret.
You have 50,000 on the dragon?
That could make this the ride of their lives.
Look at him. He's a wizard. He's headed for the video championship.
This guy.
What is that?
Power glove.
Yeah, well, just keep your power gloves up for the race.
With a touch of romance.
I am not kissing a boy.
And a ton of trouble.
That's you.
But too late.
Heartbeat now!
Sorry about that.
They'll get there any way they can.
Jimmy! Here we come!
It's Jimmy! It's
Jimmy! Come
here!
Now, what do you think you're doing to him?
All this life, you've been telling him to do what you want him to do. How about once ask what he wants to do, huh?
Now,
video on a head-on.
It's gonna take a lot of guts. A little magic. And the wizard. Fred Savage. The wizard.
The wizard. Oh my goodness. Yeah, this movie definitely sort of has it all.
That's one way to put it.
Including some stuff you really sort of wish it didn't have. I'm comedian Krissy Lenz, director of National Comedy Theater. And with me, as always, is...
Nathan Blackwell, filmmaker.
And that's all.
And that's it.
Period. End of sentence.
That's all I am.
And then we have two awesome guests today. One, our podcast listeners will recognize as the best friend of the pod, Mr. Craig Michael Curtis.
Yes, Craig Michael Curtis. I am an author and very bestest BFF of the pod.
The most available person.
Practically the third host of the show. And then we have Erica Connell.
Hi.
Ooh. Tell us about yourself, Erica.
Yeah, hi. I'm a mom. I'm a gisher, an actor, and an advocate of many different things. I have three kids, two of them on the autism spectrum, and I am happy to be here to watch this very interesting movie that I didn't watch back in the day.
So, oh, really?
Yeah, I had not heard of it or seen it up until the podcast. And
really?
Yeah, so it was quite interesting.
This was your first time.
You got through unscathed. I did. I survived it.
Did you, though? Or did you watch a lot of it and go, what?
There was definitely a lot of those moments throughout the film where I'm just like, did that really just happen?
Uh-huh.
Did it really need to happen?
Uh-huh.
That should be the log line
of the movie. The Wizard. Did that really just happen? Did that need to happen?
Exactly.
And had you seen it before, Craig?
I had seen the commercial, but I never saw the movie back when it came out. The first time I saw it was literally last night around 11 p.m.
Oh,
dang. So I remember seeing the commercials as a kid and thinking, oh, that looks so cool. It's got Super Mario Brothers 3.
Oh, yeah.
And that's not even out yet. I can go... It would be like playing the video game myself if I went to that movie. But I never actually saw the movie back then. So I was new to it as well.
Fresh eyes.
Did it need to happen? That is a good question.
What about you, Nathan?
So I saw it on home video. Mm-hmm. We me and my two younger brothers were total Nintendo nuts. And so just that there was any association with Nintendo, we had to watch it. I don't remember seeing it all the way through, even as a small kid. But the three things that I remembered from watching the movie were the power glove, of course.
How could you forget? Bad.
It's so bad.
It's so bad. Super Mario 3. Even on home video, I almost felt like that was our first time looking at it. I don't know.
Oh, yes. Absolutely. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then how they pronounced Ninja Gaiden, which was really weird because I pronounced it Ninja Gaiden. And so now it's like, what? Am I wrong? Or are they doing? I don't know. So that always stuck with me.
Well, it's like Mos Eisley.
People say it that way?
Mos Eisley. Well, it's Obi-Wan says movie. It in the first one. I always called it Mos Eisley.
Me too.
Yeah, so, me too.
But yeah, in A New Hope, Obi-Wan calls it Mos Eisley Spaceport.
Yeah, he was
Maybe
old, though.
He didn't know.
Yeah. They also can't agree on whether it's Han or Han, so...
Right,
yeah.
I blame the accents and stuff and, you know, not having a thorough world produced on, you know, like, who's doing what necessarily. We've lost some of that. Where other worlds, you know, previously got torn apart for having too much of that, so... Sorry, that's
fair, like 50 years ago, people pronounced Los Angeles Los Angeles, which is... weird and wrong.
Yes. I definitely saw this movie in the theater, and I feel like that's the only way I knew you could do those things in Super Mario, right? Like, that's how I knew that you could fly if you ran fast enough and that you could go up over the lip of that thing because it's in the movie. And if it hadn't been in the movie, how would you...
So I feel like, so nowadays, like, a video game comes out, and it comes out, like, right away, you know, or there's a very little delay. But back then, you know, most Nintendo games came out first in Japan, where Nintendo is.
Yeah.
And, like, even, like, Super Mario Brothers 2, I think what they did for, like, they didn't expect Super Mario Brothers 1 to be such a huge hit here. So they actually took another game and reskinned it. And
to be Super Mario 2?
To be Super Mario 2.
Yeah, because that one doesn't really fit.
Yeah, it's a little weirder.
Or even the other future Super Mario Brothers. Mm-hmm. Super Mario 2 is always just like really off.
Yeah, so I don't know the exact history, but Super Mario 3 definitely could have been one of those things where it came out like a year ahead in Japan, so they're able to show all this stuff beforehand, you know.
Well, it was how the product information was really released, because that's... In researching it, in the reviews that I read, it was either like people loved it or they hated it. And a lot
hated
of the
Super Mario 3 or
hated
the Wizard?
The Wizard.
Yeah.
Because the movie, they felt that the movie turned into a giant commercial. Nintendo commercial.
100%.
So it got torn apart. Like, Rolling Stone had a great scathing article on The Wizard to read.
I love that the thing they didn't like about this movie was the commercialism. When it's like, there are some other problems.
There are definitely some other problems that were very overlooked in this time frame. You know, that like now you just think that's not going to fly.
Oh, no, no.
Yeah. Even if you like set aside like the commercialism. Or, like, portrayal of people with, like, you know...
Spectrum disorders.
On the spectrum, you know. They never say what he has. It's just his disease, you know.
Let's talk about what it is. Because that's kind of the whole beginning of the movie.
Even with all those stuff, like, if I had to, like, describe the movie, it's like, if you ever wished that you were watching a movie and you were wondering what happens in between the scenes when nothing's happening, and then you include that in the movie... Well, you're in luck because that's the Wizard.
There's plenty of options.
Well, and it's almost like three different movies, right? So there's the fun, lighthearted, this is about Nintendo and about getting to a championship. So there's that movie going on. And then there's this like sort of dark family drama going on.
Uh-huh. And then there's a
maiden's romance road trip. There's a kids rom-com. Romance.
Yeah, there's the yes, you have the kids rom-com, but...
With meet cute.
Right. But I'm not going to kiss a boy, you know, and then she goes right in for it there.
Well,
we're going to have to specifically talk about that.
A very small genre. Kids romance.
The kids' rom-com.
The autism and the sickness, like, being straight off, it starts off so dark. This kid is institutionalized and on, like,
seeing him as a mother with kids
on the spectrum. I was, like, fuming. I was like, oh, my gosh, I cannot believe that this is even, like, was a thought back, you know, even back then. But then the movie is about breaking him out of that. Which I was like, fantastic. Mm-hmm. This is fabulous. Okay, I like how that is going. With the brothers are saying this is not the way it should be, and
we shouldn't treat him differently.
Exactly. Right. Even though then you learn later at the end of the movie, there's even more drama and the PTSD that the family has, the loss of a child. You know, which is like.
They sort of sprinkle that on the cup. It was his twin sister.
Yeah.
Right in front of him.
And did you guys... Yeah, so they reveal that in, like, Act 3. So
just kind of...
To back
in
up
between
a bit.
Video game challenges, by the way.
So, yeah, if you hadn't seen the movie, The Wizard... So Fred Savage is not the wizard. It's his younger brother.
That's right.
So basically, it's kind of a Rain Man situation to where it's autistic,
Muppet Babies version of Rain Man.
Yeah.
Yes.
Where
Muppet Babies Rain Man.
Basically, the kid.
It is. It really is. Oh my gosh! That is when you're. That you stole my thing from the end of what I was going to say. It's like, but it is. It is. It is the like watered down kid version for of Rain Man.
Yeah, really where is. He's a genius
he's a
at video games. Yeah, savant.
He's a savant at something, and he's a savant at video games, and you know goes on to win it. But that's the standard. That's still a typical thing that we see within film.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's Fred Savage. His younger brother, who he's taking to the video game championships,
but
and
even
then
that,
a
there's
girl
a lot of confusion
him.
About who, what the bonds are between these people. So you've got Fred Savage, and you've also got Christian Slater,
who
is definitely one of his brothers.
Right. So
their dad
older,
is Beau Bridges.
Their dad is Beau Bridges. There's a stepmom.
There's a mom,
but she's a stepmom to Christian Slater and Fred Savage. She's not their mom.
I was trying to figure out what the family situation, because I said, oh, well, he's only our half-brother. That's why you don't care about
Jimmy's
him.
Jimmy's a half-brother. So that woman is Corey, is Fred Savage and Christian Slater's stepmom, who had Jimmy and later we learn Jennifer.
Yes.
With Beau Bridges. And then they divorced after Jennifer died. Mm-hmm. And then she went on to marry the guy from car commercials.
Yes.
Who is a dick.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes. Uh-huh. Whose character had to be like the biggest douche. Like,
well,
ever.
That's what
like,
80s.
Well, that's,
I mean.
He was that. I don't remember the name of the actor, but he is like typecast as the 80s douche.
He's not Shooter McGavin, but he might as well be Shooter McGavin, right?
There were like. Three guys who operated in that space, they were probably always at the same auditions.
Uh-huh. Or like, Evil Stepdad.
Yeah.
You get this one. Uh-huh. I'll get the next one.
Yeah, exactly. Just taking turns. Sorry, bud.
Have you read this script? This movie is weird. You got this one. But I had to like sort of make a little diagram of who was who, because it's quite confusing.
Right.
The whole
I didn't
first,
put that much effort into watching the
well,
movie.
I tell you, I did too.
Little, but I was
the
like,
whole,
why do they care so much and why who is this person for a while? I didn't
why
know.
Why does the mom hate these other two
kids?
Yeah. The
like,
whole first 10-15 minutes of the movie is like this huge exposition dump. Like at the very
There's
beginning
no video games in the first 15 minutes of the movie.
Is that why you weren't paying attention, Ethan?
No.
At the very beginning of the movie when the opening credits go and the kids walking down the empty highway and then the plane swoops overhead.
There's nothing but empty landscape where these people live.
And then like, you know, you get a North by Northwest moment where the patrol plane swoops like not even like high overhead, it's like buzzing by him at 10 feet over his head.
Just scooped him up.
And then
that's actually what my son said, like, why didn't the plane just get him?
Yeah.
What do you mean, why didn't the plane
they were reaching out the window trying to grab him. Then the highway patrol guy, comes in and parks next to him, and then the dispatcher said, okay, I found him, what should I do? And the dispatcher tells him, take him to his mother's. She's remarried.
Yeah.
Yeah. What? That's important to know.
Tell me, is she happy in her job, or should what else do I need to know as I pick up this kid?
And they really make it clear through the dialogue. Well, he's just because he's our half brother, and you're like, wait, what?
The whole first 10 minutes is like trying to shoehorn as much of this complicated family situation as they can get, because they don't want to. I think they like so was really this wanted to get into
a story without Nintendo that they kind of like shoehorned it in.
This was a dark drama that was like a tearjerker Oscar bait movie. It was basically Rain Man.
Let's make a Nintendo movie. What do we have on our script pile that we can turn into a Nintendo movie?
I got Rain Man for Kids.
Yes.
Rain Man for Kids.
A Rain Man prequel. Yes. Okay.
It really does come late into the game. And so they're at like a truck stop. They're already running away because the youngest, he wanted to go to California. Fred Savage is like, screw this noise. And I'm going to take you, do what you want. And he just for a moment, the kid is playing Double Dragon at an arcade, and as Fred Savage is taking him away, he goes like, "What? You got 50,000 on Double Dragon?"
Wasn't that at the bus station?
Yeah, that's what it was. And then as soon as that happened, Fred Savage also then immediately believed that he was now a savant at video games and started putting money on it.
And Haley is the one who suggests all that.
Grifting
but
locals. So I bet you $20. My little brother.
To the point where we get even more shenanigans. We get even more shenanigans where they get chased down by the locals that they're that they're heisting,
and beat up,
and totally beaten up and like traumatized even more. It's like they can't win. These poor kids.
I think one of the things that wouldn't play today is how the message you give to kids about if you're really good at video games, run away and hitchhike as much as you can because five times out of six you will not get robbed and assaulted.
Uh-huh. This is a movie where like two things that I think are really bizarre are true. One, no adult cares about kids in the least. There is no, even their own parents, but no adults that are just in the world are like, here are three children hitchhiking or alone at a bus station, let's call someone's dad.
Bo Bridges and Christian Slater, the father and son who are going after the two brothers, they're kind of going after them, but it's really more of a road trip, and they're really more after, and this is the weirdest character,
the child bounty hunter.
Actually, Nate, we have a picture of the like child bounty
pedo
hunter.
Alert. Like, seriously, pedo alert.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, what is going
on?
No child gets away from me. I was like, oh my God.
He's got candy in his creepy car that we learned at the end.
He's luring children. And
he also threatens people with a knife at the teeniest bit of prompting.
Like,
it's because he's a pro.
It's a
small knife, though.
I kidnap runaways, but don't worry, I get paid for it.
It's a child-sized knife.
So I realize this story.
We're just trying to be safe,
Right. This story is kind of a modern retelling of the Pokemon story.
Oh my God.
Where it's three friends, it's two boys and a girl, making it across country to a championship.
There it is. You're right.
Uh-huh. Yep, there's
this hideous man. What do you think his commercials are like? Do you think he has Lerner and Rowe type commercials?
Absolutely. It's just
his face, and he's like, "Do you have a kid that's out hitchhiking?
Did your kid run away? I will capture him.
I'm no kid left behind for sure.
I don't get paid until I capture your kid.
I'm the best at grabbing kids.
I've got candy in my car. That's how you do it.
But then we use that against him.
Uh huh.
Haley, who is the heroine, or if you want to call her that, throughout this, she then to get away from the bad guy has this like really scathing moment where she screams at the top of her lungs and accuses him of touching her breast.
Yep.
And
I remember that moment from seeing it when I was 8 years old and going, why is that? What? I'm not sure.
Everyone's freaking out.
Yeah, what's going on?
And the adults and the cops who are in that, it's in a casino. He's like literally picking up the screaming Jimmy, who's like,
and no one cares at that
no
point.
No one cares.
So why was a child bounty hunter looking for kids in a casino?
I hijacked the conversation about Putnam or whatever his name is, this monster who gets hired by the mother to find her son who has special needs.
There's no care for what's going on with the kid. Like,
she
even
never
the stepfather,
checks in.
It's just the stepfather.
Yeah,
he's the one who's like, who also was very strict on like ordering that we're gonna find him this way. You can't find him this way.
They also say that guy is not gonna help bring back Fred Savage.
It's like he caught Fred Savage and said, "Where is your brother?" And then lets him go, and then goes off looking for him.
And the stepdad said, "Like, well, that one's not my my responsibility. That's Bo Bridges' problem.
Yeah, not mine. I'm not paying for that one.
I slashed his tires.
How creepy do we all think that Fred Savage is just like was born an adult? He's like a 13-year-old, 30-year-old.
A mini-me version of himself as
He's
an adult.
The most emotionally mature character in this whole story.
Air quotes again, right?
Which is not, like, not a really hugely high bar, but
it's the
yeah.
truth. You're right. Mom has completely checked out.
Yep.
She does not know how to handle, you know, the situation at all, which, hey, I understand, you know, those. I understand that as a mom. But, you know, the dad's the feud there and the just the dysfunctionality.
Mm-hmm.
It's just so rampant, this story. It's, you know, like no matter where they find it. And then the kids end up just finding even more, getting robbed again.
Robbed by, know, farmers.
And
can I just say also that particular scene where they pull, once they like look in the rearview mirror and see her with a wad of cash in the back of the
Which
truck.
Which
is
mostly $1
And then they pull
bills.
Over, and then they just start grabbing the girl, and they grab the boy, and they're just, like, yanking them out of the
That's
car.
That's our money.
You have this, like high-end banjo theme going on. I can just imagine this sort of, you know, you change the music on that or take the music away completely, that scene changes completely. It just becomes this really dark.
It becomes adults robbing children and then leaving them by the side of the road?
It's a really dark scene, but it's just like, oh, we'll just put some banjo music on there, and now it's hijinks.
But the adults in this story are all just mildly annoyed that there are unsupervised children in their midst. The guy at the bus station, the cops, the woman at the diner, everyone's just like, get these kids out of here.
Oh,
yes, you should get those kids out of there. They're in a casino.
And why are they here? Where are their
there's
parents?
There's actually laws.
And, you know, at no point do we ever take a harder look at Haley's story. Why was she just at a bus station alone? All the stories she tells about...
Oh, no, she says.
She knows
because,
truckers. Her dad's
yeah,
sending
her dad's
her
dad's a trucker, yeah. And her dad felt bad about taking her all over the country in this truck, so he left her to his own her own devices instead to walk around, you know, rural Nevada.
To take the bus home.
And now she's a con man who talks like a middle-aged man wrote all of her dialogue.
And what you have to ask yourself is... why does she know all these things? Like, why does she think to say, like, I know how to get rid of this guy. Don't worry about it. This old trick.
Yeah,
he touched
yeah.
my breast. Like, whoa.
And
Haley,
like,
how old again? Pump the brakes.
Yeah, it's just like, you're not even 16 yet, and you know
but,
this. Like, you know,
and
or
no
like
one
18.
At the
like,
end.
You shouldn't even know that that's a thing. Like,
the end of the story, she just, like, is with Corey, yeah, like, Corey's family.
I guess
family.
She's yeah. our sister now.
Yeah, none of the adults
is
are like,
that how
could we
out?
Just talk for a second about who this child is?
Where did she come from, and
who
what are we
is
doing
she?
With her?
What is your name, sweetheart? Like,
stepdad did not come out and say, I'm not responsible for this one, though. So, hey,
nope.
I know, maybe he
they
changed.
They just take
changed
her
man.
Home
they're,
with them.
They're pretty loosey-goosey on unaccompanied minors yes. in general in that particular family, so.
Oh, my God.
And, yeah. But, okay.
And then back to the bounty hunter for kids. All the adults resort to violence so quickly, including slamming their cars into each other.
Yeah.
That's what
full
I mean. Like,
speed.
Bo Bridges and Christian Slater, by the end of the movie, I don't even think they're looking for the brothers anymore.
No.
They're just going
oh,
after
no,
the bounty
not.
Hunter.
Like, yeah.
It's like,
and it's
they
so
see
shocking.
Him, let's ram him and take out his car.
Their part of it is like Mad Max.
And then
yeah.
At the very end,
it's
when
like
they go,
Thelma and Louise.
There's like the Universal tour, and
yeah.
the kids are on the Universal like tram ride, and the bounty hunter's on the Universal tram ride. And then Christian Slater and Bo Bridges co-chasing after it. And I'm convinced that they're going after the bounty hunter and not the kids who are also on that train.
They're not even worried
and
about it.
And they get in a fist fight with the bounty hunter guy, that guy. And instead of, like, oh, our kids are running away. No, no, let's go punch this guy some more.
It's also a commercial for Universal Studios. Let's not forget
that. Oh, yeah.
That. We get a whole...
As much as it is a video game.
So movie. That's another... there are at least three Pee-wee's Big Adventure tie-ins. One of them being the chase through a movie studio. The second being that Christian Slater, at one point early in the movie, which I want to talk for just a minute about why Christian Slater is in this movie, because it doesn't make any sense. mm-hmm. He says, like, chill out, Dad. It's not like I'm cutting tags off mattresses, which apparently we were real worried about that in 1989. Did someone in 1989 like get arrested for that and like put in prison for the rest of their life?
I think that was just sort of
low hanging comedy fruit.
Yeah, like, it was like
you
a
had
stand-up
a mattress, and there was a do not cut off thing. And for some reason, it got into the zeitgeist, and it became low-hanging comedic fruit.
Like, well, I'm airline bringing it back.
Food. Yeah.
I'm bringing it back.
Bringing it back.
And then I think they actually mentioned Pee-wee Herman.
Oh, yeah, yeah, on one of the...
Yeah. Pee-wee Herman. Do you remember what moment it was?
It was...
A new movie with Pee-wee Herman, a romance.
Josh on Gabor,
that's right.
Yes, our in case it didn't come through on the audio, our lovely audience member pointed out that it is on the tram when they talk about an upcoming romantic comedy between Pee-wee Herman and Zsa Zsa Gabor.
Just to picture that again, it's one of those, did we really need to have that moment?
Well, did we? That's from a different movie.
I don't know.
Pee-wee Herman was a giant of the late 80s.
Absolutely. So Christian Slater, so I kind of looked it up because I was very confused. In the trailer, Fred Savage is top built.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And he's just coming off of Princess Bride. Like,
Fred
he's
Savage
and the
Wizard.
And the Wonder Years.
Princess Bride, yeah. The Wonder Years, and Little Monsters is also the same year as this. So he's a huge star. And Christian Slater is not quite there yet. But he's been in Heathers. Heathers exists. In The Name of the Rose. Didn't that movie get nominated for Oscars?
I don't know about that.
Do you
that
even
one.
Know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
There are barely any video games in that movie, though.
You're right.
Yeah, Beau Bridges is the quote-unquote star.
Yeah. He's the biggest. When I saw the cast-wise, I was pretty excited about it. I was like, okay, this is going to be great. why did I go in with expectations?
I was upset that the Power Glove was not listed as a cast
member. As a cast member, yeah.
It really should have been.
That should be the cast list, just the things that it's a commercial for. Super Nintendo 3, right. Mario 3, Universal Studios, Power Glove.
And some actors.
Fred Savage, then underneath. Oh, wow. But Young Guns 2 and Pump Up the Volume came out in 1990, so I guess Christian Slater...
He was just arriving.
Yeah.
Just getting going there.
Just showing up with his gravelly voice goodness.
He wasn't a star enough yet to where he could say no to this role, and it was still like, I gotta do what's coming at me.
I'm taking it. I think I mentioned this in the Young Guns. Maybe not, because he's only in Young Guns 2, but I do have an autographed photo of Christian Slater that I sent away for... In like the back of a like Teen Beat magazine, like they would list all the addresses of the young stars of the day, and if you sent a letter in the mail with a stamp,
in the mail,
yes. This thing where a man comes to your home.
How do you email a stamp?
Collects paper and then takes it away and brings it to a place. So I have an autographed photo of Christian Slater.
Because his address popped up in the magazine. I'm sure he appreciates that. And so that anyone who wants his autograph can send him a
letter. So it's kind of like in comic books how in the back there were advertisements for sea monkeys and stuff. So in Teen Beat and Tiger Beat, you flip to the back and there.
Was this with his consent? Did he say, yeah, go ahead and put my address in the back of this Teen
Beat?
Yeah,
yeah, it was like their fan mail.
It's not
like
they had his address.
They had their fan base that ran, collecting all of their mail and sending out the materials and stuff like that. So if you were hit that part of being in Teen Beat magazine, that was one of the hookups, is you had that connection with your fans a little bit more. Hey, it was dreamy, man. You could get
and that was posters. That was the only way to show your fandom was to buy those magazines, tear out the pictures, paste them to your wall, and maybe write a letter to Mark Paul Gosselaar, who never returned my message. Christian Slater did, though, so he is warm in my heart. Behind us is an image of Tobey Maguire, who's in this movie. I just thought we should all know.
Oh, man.
There he is.
Baby Tobey Maguire.
There he is.
Oh,
there
yeah.
He is. Wow. Is this his debut?
It is his on-screen debut.
Awesome.
Wow.
The Wizard.
Practically his off-screen debut.
When I first saw it, I was convinced he was the chubbier kid, and I was like, wow. And then, no, I looked just over the chubby kid's shoulder, and I was like, oh, that's Tobey Maguire.
Is that a mullet?
Yeah.
Of course it is.
It was the 80s.
It
was the late 80s.
It's probably a hypercolor shirt.
Wow.
It does look like one, doesn't it? I just want to slap his chest now.
So this movie is 1989. There's so many things in it that started... I mean, that looks so 90s.
Mm-hmm.
Especially towards the end. And how everything, it's like a lot of the colors just reminded me of like Power Rangers, yep. And like
very neon,
yeah, like the first computer like visual effects and mm-hmm. and the neons, and also like the need that it's the thought that it's okay to have like red and blue and yellow and green and purple all in the same set, you yeah. know, just like all together.
Well, it's very brought to you by Nickelodeon.
Yeah, yes, exactly.
Absolutely. I was definitely waiting for a couple of those "when are they going to get slimed" moments, because mm-hmm. there was definitely some setups for it. I was like, come on. Like, you know, I wanted a Home Alone punchline here or there, a little bit more comedic relief in there. And I didn't get it. I was a little disappointed by that, because like, it
the
just
director
turned
thought
creepy.
He was making a noir movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was not sure about the comedy.
It was definitely a dramedy.
And the stuff that's in there that is meant to be funny is actually, like, it's almost all disturbing.
Yeah.
Including the moment from the trailer where he's like, yeah, well, just keep your power gloves off her. And it's like, first of all, he has not acknowledged that she exists.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's directed at his smart means. I don't know what the name of that character is. Like
Lucas,
that's right. Yeah. I kept thinking of him as Chet. He looks like a Chet.
He's just, oh my gosh, like Weird Science.
Yeah, he. I don't know. Just
that's
Chet
what,
is
when I think of Chet. That's
super
Weird Science.
Rich, pretentious guy, and you know, he's living in rural Nevada, but
alone.
He owns
all these kids just live alone.
There's
in
no
trailers.
Adults around, and no one ever discusses why aren't you
just
in
like
school,
Pokemon.
So I assume
just
it's in the summer.
Exactly. You didn't get to finish your Pokemon analogy.
Oh, that's okay. Oh, yeah. It was deeper, but let's continue.
No. Please.
Free friends, wander off.
Let's continue.
We're just kind of all over the place. There's no yeah. rhyme or reason.
Lucas owns every Nintendo game. All
Lucas
97.
Is the Gary Oaks of Pokemon.
He has 97 video games. Well, wait. Let's circle back to the keep your power gloves off for a moment. Well, I guess it all ties in with the discussion of Lucas. What even is he? Like, he's a child, too. We have to assume.
Well, yeah,
that
he's
they're
definitely
all under 15,
teenager, you know, going on here. But he's
got minions.
Yeah,
the following.
Well, every bully they come across comes in a pack of three, basically.
Yeah,
they
so
really
do. He's got his two minions, and then they have another bully who's got two minions, and then you know the farmer. I think had a couple of guys with him when they. Pull over and rob them and leave them on the street.
It was just the two of them that just, one.
Can we watch the clip of meeting Lucas and just hear him brag about his
power glove?
Lucas. Lucas? Nobody's better than Lucas. Lucas is awesome.
Why is that kid also unsupervised?
And where might we find us, Lucas?
On a porch.
He's so cool.
The music, though. I love the Western music. That I'm sorry. That happens again, and it just. I love how they come back with it. It's great.
This guy, I don't get it. Is he like a poster child for someone?
What does that mean?
For your information, butthead, he's headed for the video championships in Los Angeles.
Is that right? Well, let's just see how good he is, then. Guys?
Hold my sunglasses.
This is just like a Pokemon battle.
It is.
I have 97.
Unsupervised children.
No adults.
This is what happens. They start to video game battle it out.
Mm-hmm.
That's at least a safer way.
Okay, so he's got a case with his name on it, and there's the power glove.
And the bulletproof case.
Drastically changes the drama.
They're watching Hollywood Squares. Jim J. Bullock on the TV right there.
His groupie's just setting it up right now.
Right. Setting up his microphone and bottle of water.
They're on a screened-in patio. It's in Arizona.
Uh-huh. They're a great pick, though. Oh, they really are.
This is Rad Racer.
Rad Racer.
Look how straight he drives.
With the power glove.
Hey,
It's so bad.
So bad.
Yeah, well, just keep your power gloves off her, pal, huh? Go ahead, Jimmy, show them what you got.
Even the little kid's like, just ease up, Fred Savage. Yeah,
his little brother was like a little, like, you know, come
seriously,
on.
Seriously, you're embarrassing me. I'm out of here. Yeah.
I had to bring up captions. It almost sounded like he said, I love Power Glove. It was so bad. And that's true. So apparently, so this is like, what, the Wii 15 years before, 20 yeah. years before, whatever.
Basically.
And really, to press the buttons, like the A and B buttons on that, you're just moving your little finger, you're moving your finger and your thumb the whole time, every time you're jumping and pressing. How exhausting would that be? Just your first finger and your thumb.
And I'm thinking about it and doing it now in the air.
And they didn't...
It looks cool when you're doing it.
Because I look arthritic doing it.
Yeah.
So.
No, you look like... it's again, before your time, it looks like Thanos. You're just kind of reaching out
controlling
and magically controlling fate.
You know what it looks like? It looks exactly like in the movie Johnny Mnemonic, where he goes into the computer world and he just is a hand that's moving and selecting things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that was 2000... and something.
Right.
So
might be 2000.
Might be.
Watch, it's 1999.
Yeah. It came out right after this. But they invented a lot of games that they thought would be so cool for the Power Glove, and they were mostly like you're stocking shelves and you just grab a can and put it where it goes.
Yeah.
You know, turn a dial, slightly balance something like this. But yeah,
shelf
it's exactly,
stalker
other
from
punching other than some of the more violent games, but
yeah.
So
another thing I want to bring up is video game playing acting.
Yes.
It's almost on par with movie driving, where you've got... So the way that they do these driving rigs is that they're actually not controlling the car. It's being pulled along. It's actually being put up on something. So even if you turn the wheel, nothing's going to happen. So you get people who are driving like this. It looks like they're weaving between trees, like in Endor or something like that. And so, so the video game acting, especially from... people who have no idea what a video game is, it's not like when you actually play it. Here, Craig, actually pretend to play a Nintendo game. All right. Yep, your hands are still. Yep, and it's just your thumbs that are moving. That's how you play a video game. And so these guys, it's like, again, it's almost like it's a virtual reality rig. Mm-hmm. They're holding the tiny controller, and they're flying over the room, and every moment is like, oh my god, it's so dangerous.
Behind the back.
I've just learned I've been video gaming the entire time, because that is exactly how I look.
Yep.
I am driving that car, and I am like falling over to my left completely, over to my right, you know? I mean, if I'm... That is probably why
I play VR,
is because I will just fall and trip and all that shenanigans happens, because it happened just with the regular Nintendo.
Yep.
Maybe imagine I repress my emotions too much and I'm just too cold.
I was going to also say my son always ends up sweaty when he's done playing video games, because he's like, jump, 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 dodge to the left, dodge to the right.
Right.
He's living that moment. But I think you're right. I think adults, especially adult men, just sit there and it's all thumbs.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't even like move their
zen.
Heads.
Even PC gaming, I find myself sometimes I will actually move and
grab the monitor. And...
yeah, I have had a couple of rage moments there where I almost did that. But you know, I will like with my mouse, I'll be like, all right, you know, just move around. Still, like I can't control myself. I have to move with whatever action's happening on the screen, like with me.
An actor, would like if someone was like, no, act like you're playing a video game, wouldn't you add some?
Absolutely. I'm gonna add in a little bit of, yeah, I'm going this way. I'm doing great. You know, you got to add in that drama, the over exaggeration. So, but they really took it to another level.
Oh, they did. They really
they
were.
Did.
There was
we're
so
talking
much
about
acting.
You, Bo Bridges.
Yeah.
Yes, that's my son
that was,
up there.
That was the dad story arc. Was that at the beginning of the movie? He's arguing with his older son, Christian Slater, about
who we learn.
Junk
it
food
was the cause
and
of Jennifer's death.
And
Oh, because he was supposed to be babysitting.
Yep, and that was the source of their strained relationship.
Yeah, so, but again, that just kind of gets shoehorned into the first 10 minutes, or just, it's just a big mess in terms of the backstory of these characters. But they go on the road trip. He and the son go on the road trip, and at the beginning, Christian Slater decides as a hoot to bring his Nintendo with him on this road trip where they're trying to find his two brothers. Oh, just, I'll bring my... You know, I'll bring my Nintendo and some games in case we have a moment.
But not
in,
97
in this desperate
games.
Search.
Because Lucas Barton has 97 games.
Yes, correct. Not 97 games. He has a select few, like Zelda 2 and Super Mario Brothers 2.
And Ninja Turtles.
And so, yeah, at the beginning, like, they're getting their car repaired, and he's, like, in the back of the repair shop, and he plugged his Nintendo into the TV just for a quick game, and then the dad is like, oh, you're wasting your time with those video games are for losers and idiots. And then, like, at the hotel later, Bo Bridges is up all night playing the video games, and his arc is complete now. He's now obsessed with video games, because the rest of the movie, it's now Christian Slater's like, yeah, shouldn't we be finding the lost kids? No, I've gotten the golden key. Yeah. I can get past the river of
what
blood.
What he's really saying is like, no, I've found a way to escape the terrible reality that I live in.
Exactly.
Now I want to live in, what's the name of the Zelda world? Damn it, it would have been funny.
Hyrule.
Okay, sorry, guys.
You can edit it in. Wow. Say Hyrule.
Oh, I'm just going to escape my troubles and go live in Hyrule now. I'm going to edit out all the other stuff, and people are going to think I'm so cool.
That's right.
You're 100% right. That's at the end. Everybody completely ends whatever they were upset about once they realize
everyone goes
that
to the video game contest.
Yeah. Oh, and he's doing well. That's like the biggest thing, you know,
including
like,
the bounty hunter.
Yeah, the bounty hunter.
I know that kid. That's creepy too.
It's so creepy.
Didn't the stakes entirely vanish at that point?
Yeah.
Whether he won or not, everyone's with him now.
An alternate reality. Like, this entire movie posits a world where children don't need supervision and that video games...
Hitchhiking is awesome.
But it's that video games have this so much importance, it's almost kind of like playing like a game of pool that you just bet on these things. Like, there were like two businessmen in their 50s playing an arcade game.
The only adults we see in the entire movie.
Like traveling salesmen really into this arcade game, and then they even like bet on it and then they lose. So this, and then the idea of this championship is so big that it converts everyone, including the bounty hunter. I know that guy. It's just this skewed alternate version of reality.
Mm-hmm. Also, that video game championship had a very large and enthusiastic crowd watching other people play video games.
Oh, yeah.
And the weirdest host.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
yeah.
So aggressive.
He was
part of my job is hosting events. And I'll tell you what won't happen is that I won't not have any confirmation that our third contestant is there and just...
Hope
introduce
he
him
appears
and the third person Jimmy,
maybe I don't see him. Jimmy is here.
Still haven't had word. Jimmy, anybody?
Hello,
Bueller,
right? Like, that's not how you handle
just move on without pointing out that the third contestant is missing, right?
Yeah, but I do, but I think that maybe
again,
is
no
the best
care
part
for
of
the
movie,
kids
where the screen comes up and he's just back there like, hi.
Oh. Holding his little lunchbox.
I'm Jimmy, this is my lunchbox.
Yeah, so for the audience at home and here, the movie ends with the big video game showdown in Los Angeles.
Yeah, part one of the movies ends with that.
But the whole idea is that they've been on the road, but they've been playing video games.
Oh, can we watch the montage of her calling Nintendo Power Magazine, where one guy works in a room full of binders? It's the
best job ever.
So this is the version of the training montage like you see in Rocky.
League office. Nintendo game playing. This is Rick. How can I help you?
Hi, my name is Haley, and I've got a wizard who's going all the way to the championships in Los Angeles.
Is that so?
All I need is a little help. Okay, let's start with Simon's Quest.
Okay, now where exactly are you?
Dinosaurs, bubblegum.
They're in a casino.
And,
is that like a 14-year-old cocktail waitress?
Yeah, she looks more like 9 dressed up to be like 16, but yeah, definitely.
And Fred Savage is wearing sunglasses inside and being a douche.
Perfect.
It's, he's got his risky
well, it is Reno.
Going on. This is, that's the now the Rain Man look.
Yep, yeah, exactly.
He's in the Tom Cruise moment.
So here's the thing, though, is that the kid, the wizard, is practicing on an arcade game and not a Nintendo. And they're that's radically right. different.
That's exactly right.
But this guy, the tech support guy, is becoming really invested right now.
Yep.
Not that he'll ever show up in the movie again.
Oh, Mega Man.
And I thought
Mega
Jake
Man.
From State Farm had a hard job. Yeah. This guy.
Yeah, the arcade version and the home versions were always different, like radically different, even like a different story.
Yep. Look at all the paper cups he's got. Haley is by the pool reading a Cosmo. Not appropriate.
Metroid. Best game ever.
Oh, I had that game.
RC Pro-Am.
Is that Contra?
Where are
two?
There's two.
What is she writing on these pages? That what is this man telling
tips
her?
Tips and tricks,
I
guess.
Scores and stuff from each of the games. And she's like calling in saying he's done this amazing. Here's
that's
Contra, $1,000 score.
Yeah. Ninja Gaiden.
Now she is losing enthusiasm and she is gaining enthusiasm.
Yeah.
She's like, I'm gonna ditch these guys and find some new kids to grift with.
Yeah.
It's worth noting, by the way, they have him training, we need you to be great at every single Nintendo game. And in the end, when they go to the gaming championship, the initial round is Ninja Gaiden.
Yep.
As we're calling it. Which he was already naturally good at.
Yeah.
So those other 96 games that he trained so intensely on and called tech support and spent hours and hours on, pointless.
Waste of time.
There's no points in Legend of Zelda.
No.
Why would you need to...
No.
Why do you have to master that? Like, how do you master that?
Yeah.
And some of these is like,
round
all right, get as far as you can in Super Mario 2 in 10 minutes. Well, everyone can get kind
10
of...
10 minutes! That's it! That's all... 10 minutes?
Yeah. You'll get to 2 levels, and everyone will get to 2 levels, and so whoever gets slightly more coins
on the way... But that would be the better strategy, would just be to, like, kill something and get coin.
Yeah.
Rather than to try and get to the end. But I do love the end where Jimmy is trying to win this competition, and talk about video game acting, Lucas is, like, glancing over.
So intense. He's coming up on me.
Looking at him will somehow do
I'll watch his game instead and see how well
he's
doing.
So it comes down to 3 people at the very end.
Jimmy.
Lucas.
And Mora.
And Mora.
Who comes out of nowhere and should have won.
And goes tonight, yeah.
Because it would be a better movie if she won.
It would have been so much better. There are 2 things that would have made this a better movie. I'll tell you the other one in a minute.
There are 22 things.
two changes I would have made and would have made it, you know, it'd still be itself, but it would have made it better. But one is, is her name Mora?
Mora.
See, at this point, all his family is in the crowd cheering him on. His conflict about being sent to an asylum or something is pretty much done. The family's coming together already.
Mm-hmm.
Whether he wins or loses is kind of immaterial. I mean, Haley
gets
a new trailer home, I think, if they win the prize.
I don't think they would have taken him home. I think that stepdad would have thrown him right back into...
If he lost?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
All right, if he wins,
I
love him now.
He's got to prove his worth right now, and that's how he did. He had to win something and do something so grandiose in order for his family to say, hey, we accept you for who you are.
But they still send him home with Beau Bridges.
Yeah.
And they allow Beau Bridges to drive them home in the bed of a truck.
If Mora,
from
though,
Los Angeles to Utah.
In the back
safe.
Of the truck, yeah.
That was safe back then, right?
Yeah, back on the freeway. When,
oh, yeah.
With the child
pushing,
they kidnapped.
Pushing 80.
Yeah, who's known for just leaving things and, you know, taking off.
But Mora should have won. Like, they should have just, okay, Lucas is a jerk. And, you know, Jimmy's just playing the play.
Mm-hmm.
And so just give it to Mora. What does she ever do to anybody? Now
Not
she comes in third.
Well, we got, like, throughout the movie, we at least had interactions with Lucas. So we knew who his character was. And then, like you said, Maura was totally just thrown out there. I want to know a little bit more about her. How did she get there? You know, I didn't get any of that interaction. How come
she just happened to be at Universal Studios that day with her family?
She's a finalist. She's a wizard, too.
And, you know, we know nothing about her other than, you know, she does some of her great acting there, too, her video game acting with the, moments and stuff and just really plowing on. And I'm just thinking, somebody didn't shave her mustache.
Oh, poor Maura.
I was like, Maura, somebody didn't shave Maura's mustache. I felt bad for her.
Get that waxed. Poor thing. But yeah, there is the whole creepy romance element too between Fred Savage and Haley, where it's like, we don't need that. So if we're making this movie better, just eliminate that whole thing, because he even like
he's
negging her.
You need to
kissing
add this. They can't just have sort of an unspoken chemistry. Not that they do, but
because they're
children. They need to have a scene where they talk about kissing and then they kiss because they don't want to kiss or something. Just, I don't know, write it
they
in there.
They must
somewhere
have been legally obligated to make sure that this movie had to be like 105 minutes. There's no reason why this movie was 105 minutes unless there was a legal repercussion.
It can't be a commercial for Nintendo unless it's 105 minutes
in order that qualifies for the movie being a full-fledged movie instead.
Yeah.
So I tallied every time I paused the movie to see how much was left.
Oh, no. Oh, Nathan. How many times?
15.
Oh, dang. Oh, gosh.
It was.
Yikes. How early did you start?
2 minutes in.
Oh, God. 2 minutes in, you're like, wait a minute.
But
wait
to
a
be
minute
honest, it was like, okay, how long?
What am
is
I getting
this
into here? Goodness. All right. Is there anything that we missed that anybody wants to?
I wanted to mention
to?
One, the second thing I thought that would have made this a more entertaining movie is you keep the child bounty hunter in, but you replace him with a better child bounty hunter, the one from Raising Arizona.
Oh,
that would have made the subplot where they're like crashing into each other's cars much more interesting when you're doing it with this big, what's his name, Randall Cobb, I think? The big hairy biker with a bandolier of grenades. And it would have been like genuinely intimidating instead of really just completely creepy. Yeah. But yeah, that if you had somehow crossed that character over and had him in there instead of the guy we got.
The creepy, creepy, creepy.
You don't have to change much of anything else. Just put him in there because that would have been so much more fun.
Or if you hired, instead of just like a single dude, like you hired a company that does this. And then you put like this weird twist that they've got this van like with four guys in it.
Yeah.
A windowless van.
A windowless
van. Full of candy.
It's a child catching SWAT team.
Yeah.
They have candy in there too.
And, they're communicating with base and it's like just overdone.
We came to this diner where we heard the kids had been seen. Yeah, they're not here, but there are 47 other unsupervised children. I feel like we could pick probably a bounty on them, too.
It's payday. Yeah. How do you think we pay for this van?
I want to talk just briefly about the actual end of the movie where they go to California. And that's another Pee Wee Herman tie-in because they go to Cabazon where the dinosaurs are.
Yeah.
That's Jimmy's California. And we finally see, well, we learn halfway through the movie, but the family learns what's in this lunchbox that he carries around, which is photographs and mementos of his dead sister, because he wants to leave her someplace where they were all happy together, their whole family, excluding stepdad from car commercials.
And Haley.
And Haley.
She's not in there
yet. She's not in there.
She's not, she wasn't
wait,
part of it.
Wait, who are
she's
you?
Do you two know each
wait,
other?
I'm sorry, where are you from?
And are we keeping this child? I don't think we should keep this child. And
free?
That's the moment when the mom is like, you should take both our sons home. Or and it's like, but there's three of them, actually. There's actually three. She's like, no, I'm still not cool with Christian Slater. You should have been watching them.
That's in the next movie.
She's a great mother.
She's we so loving get the end of that, but like the thing
just
that
like the mom
too,
in Pokemon.
Obviously, their treatment of
my
wait, what? There's a
forget
mom
helicopter
Pokemon
parent.
Yeah, and she's not concerned at all about her kid just running
she
across the country.
She hired a much better bounty hunter to track him down.
Oh, they hire a Pikachu actually to track him down.
More subtle.
Sorry,
your point was.
I forgot what I was going to say. Oh, well, they sort of imply that he caught autism from having watched his sister die. And they also sort of imply she had the same thing. Like, he says, like, she didn't even try to swim out of the lake. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? She wasn't trying to.
Confusing that they, the way they were explaining it, like, she didn't even, like, she wasn't even downstream or something like that. And they didn't say she drowned. She just said she died.
Yeah, it was really, I was confused on how she actually died and, like, you know.
And he was watching her but wouldn't save her.
I think that they had this whole family backstory that was a movie in and of itself. And they had to cut out pretty much all of it to fit in the video game stuff. And the kid romantic subplot. But I think that they had this very complicated thing about this kid who was learning to overcome the loss of his twin sister and the breakup of his family. And, you know, this person was married to this person, and they broke up, and then this person had this person, they had kids, and then this person died, and then they broke up, and now this person lives with this person, and this person is remarried. And they just, like, rather than simplify this and say, okay, well, yes, this family is split up. And this little kid is not gotten over the death of his twin sister. Let's leave it there. Instead, they kept all of the unspoken backstory in and tried to cram it into half of a scene at the very end to kind of give it more pathos. But they didn't want to cut it out and simplify it. They just said, well, we'll imply that there was a thing. Something specifically happened with the sister, and anything we had about Christian Slater's character being negligent or drama that they originally had this movie for. I just feel like the guy who came up with this story originally was, like, crying when they said, no, this was a whole movie in and of itself. We're cutting everything out, putting in Super Mario Brothers 3 and Fred Savage. And
it was just a rewrite that they end up having to, like, you know, refilm later to make this
movie
work. But
they should have just, like, simplified the tragedy plot as well, and they didn't. So now they have these loose threads hanging about what exactly happened here. It's still very vague, but I guess it's resolved because...
He's going to get better now that he delivered his lunchbox.
Yeah, I guess that's, you know, our Sleepless in Seattle moment. They meet.
Now he's cured.
Yeah.
I think in the 80s, it felt like they wanted to say autism, but they were afraid to. And so they just said, no, he's traumatized, and so he can be fixed.
Yeah.
And they didn't know what else to do with it, so they just kind of kept it vague and sketchy.
He can be fixed by Nintendo.
By video
which
game.
You can buy for the low price of, like, didn't you feel like maybe at the end of the movie people should have been handing out?
Yeah. I think you got coupons when you went inside.
That would have been so good is if at the end of the movie, then it just goes straight into, now for this, you can purchase. So
I'm Fred Savage. To redeem your ticket, to get 10% off of the Power Glove.
Or when you buy your ticket, you get a free subscription to Nintendo Power Magazine.
Yeah, absolutely.
And Universal Studios. And you're going to get a coupon book when you leave the theater tonight. And
Power Magazine?
There was Nintendo Power, right?
Yeah.
And then there's also Power Magazine, like the unofficial Nintendo guide.
Nice. This is an image I found. There was a lot of things that you can find if you look for it. It was like why the movie is incorrect, but neither of those Nintendos are turned on.
Oh, we're going to still...
The power button is not... The red light is not on. That's something I found on the internet.
If we're going to be picky about that, I want to add one that I was not going to mention, but now I will. I didn't know where they were in Utah originally, but they were at a Utah bus station, and they wanted to get to L.A., and they said it was going to be like $225 to take a bus, one-way trip to L.A., and I felt like that was an awful lot.
Like, so, they could have flown for that much?
Yeah, I looked up Greyhound today, actually last night, and it said, I just said Salt Lake City. Salt Lake City to Los Angeles, and it was $110, which is almost half. Of what they said, and that's in today's dollars, and so it's sort of a ticky-tack thing to complain about based on everything else to complain about. So I didn't want to, but with your power, if we're just doing inconsistencies and errors,
it's like complaining about wallpaper when the Titanic is singing.
I felt like they said $100,
which is my brand, basically.
They had said $100, and it doesn't even like kill the whole plot line that they had, where it's just too expensive, and Fred Savage had no advanced planning for this, apparently. $7 was going to get him to L.A. But it's going to be like $90 to do one-way
I think he thought they were going to ride a skateboard the whole way.
And they do for... And that was the other thing.
In the back of, you know, Hostess commercials.
From right the yeah, supervised Hostess, bread trucks.
Yes, you know. A cross-country Hostess truck.
I love and, that. I wanted a ho-ho really bad. Afterwards, oh, yeah. I was like, dang it, I want a ding-dong now. Like,
three-quarters of the movie is them getting from somewhere in Utah to Reno, Nevada.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's a pretty sizable journey, especially if you don't have conventional means of transportation, but they do hitchhiking. They hooker by crook, they're getting from there to Reno. And then when we get to the third act of the story, it's just from Reno, which is almost as far away to LA as Salt Lake City is, distance wise Reno to LA, it's just
with truckers.
Yeah, Stinky, or whatever his name was.
Spanky is
Spanky.
His name.
Oh, there's a guy who will take us to LA.
Let's stick to
I just never bothered to tell you guys. And then it's just fade out, fade in. We're in LA now. And like three quarters of their long road trip is just, and then they got there.
Them hitchhiking.
Well, I love their Reno experience, though. I that made me excited to go to Reno. Because I was like, I never saw Reno through the eyes of, you know...
Anyone can gamble in Reno.
Anybody
have you
can.
Visited Reno through the eyes of a child?
Where prostitution is legal.
Right. And they have arcades that are like casinos complete with the waitresses, as we
child
saw.
Labor's yeah. legal there in Reno because you're 13.
You need a child waitress
candy cigarettes
in Reno.
While on the floor.
You need child romance.
All right. That's a line from the trailer. Romance! Like... No, there shouldn't be romance.
Don't worry, it's barely there.
On a scale of 1 to 10, one to 10 lunchbox power gloves. Power gloves, perfect. I was going to say lunchboxes full of cherished mementos of your dead sister. We'll go power gloves. So on a scale of 1 to 10 power gloves, how many power gloves do you give the movie, Erica?
Oh, 4.
Four power gloves?
Yeah, 4 power gloves.
That's generous.
I'll be generous, yeah. It holds on, you know, for like when it came out, because when I started talking about it and I brought it up to folks, you know, who might have seen the movie, I was actually really surprised on how many people had seen it. Yeah. I was like, I haven't seen it. And everybody's like, oh yeah, it was the greatest movie ever and we saw Mario 3 and blah blah blah. And I was like, okay, maybe it's not so bad. But yeah, no, I'll be generous just because it does have a following of people who still really liked the movie.
But they only remember the Nintendo
they
part.
They only remember the 20-minute segment at the end.
Yeah, that's all. Yeah, they
that's all I remember.
Can't possibly remember the other traumatizing moments. And I thought Disney was bad with killing off, you know, moms at the beginning of every movie. But this like they just, you know, we're gonna institutionalize the kid, and then at the end we're gonna kill off the twin sister and tell you why we're actually traumatized into a dysfunctional family. You know, but it's all happy ending because he still won. Yay!
They go to Universal Studios.
Oh, they don't go to Disneyland afterwards? Just kidding.
They can't. They have to contractually.
They stay in Universal. Man. That's why you don't win American Idol.
They went to Knott's Berry Farm. They won't care.
Aww.
I'm giving this movie 3 power gloves.
Okay. 3 power gloves. Wow. You didn't like it at all. Nothing redeemable?
Just honestly, I would have given a lower score except for like the 20-minute video game championship. That was fun. That had production design and it was fun and it brought back memories, but the rest of it, oh man.
What about you, Greg?
I give it 2 power gloves with a faulty cord.
Ooh, wow. Wow.
I guess I was being generous.
It's strictly for show because, you know, you have the nostalgia value with the video games, but at the same time, it really feels like it was, hey, look at, it was a, you know, a 95 minute or however long it was.
105 minutes.
I didn't.
1 hour, 45 minutes.
I did not count how many times I looked to see how much time was left. I didn't think to do that.
Did you beat my score?
I may have. Because it was constantly. It was like, all right, I'm going to have to stop here and just kind of collect myself. There was very little to redeem itself in terms of the nostalgia value for me because I just, I already remember those. I remembered most of the video games.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess it gets the 2 for that alone. It was the hitchhiking thing that really got to me. It was like their second, they hitchhike one time, then they hitchhike another time, then the third time. She's like saying, no, we can trust these guys. It's the trucker's code. And then she starts counting money. They pull over, and they are like manhandling these kids mm-hmm. and yanking money out of their clothes, take all of the money, and then just dump them over the side. And like, but then they go back to hitchhiking. Like,
the mistake
that,
they made was that they were farmers. Learned. That's not the farmer's code.
Yeah, no. Farmers don't have a code. No. Farmers are kill or be killed.
And
yeah,
we didn't really mention it, but when Haley saves the day by screaming, "He touched my breast!" And I was like, okay, that's a little off, especially considering how they didn't react when the guy was carrying off a screaming kid. But the little girl shouts, and then they all rush in, and they don't like bring the kids with them to take their testimony or get them back to their parents. No, let's just grab this guy by each limb and
just like
ram him through the door. And it's like, okay, that joke did not work for me. And then they did it two more times. He's on the payphone saying, you know, calling the mom saying, "Oh, I'm close. He touched my breast. She doesn't even have any breasts." And he's like yelling this off the street. And then afterwards, he gets beat up by truckers who apparently know her. And mm-hmm. she told them
Spanky
that
in his
the
game.
Same thing.
Yeah.
So you touched her breast, huh? And that was the worst one because you have these big truckers who have a very strong affinity to this girl who's like
a
daughter of theirs. The worst they did when they found out this guy molested her was give him a black eye and let send him on his way.
Uh-huh. No consequences.
No. None of this worked for me, and I felt like the...
You feel like I should apologize for having made you watch it? Because that's what I'm hearing you say, Craig.
I will await your apology, but we'll see what your score is.
Krissy, what's your vote?
I give it a 5 power gloves because I think that this is a category of movies I love, which is... You show them to people who have never saw them in the 80s, and they just go, "What is this?" And you're like, "Right? What is this? What were
really
they thinking?"
Yeah,
it doesn't make any sense at all. Uh-huh. So on that, this scores a 10 out of 10, if that's your only scale, is to be like, "Can you believe this nonsense?" But I'll give it a 5 because, yeah, it's not that enjoyable to watch.
Tag so we're going to give it a 5 because it's not enjoyable to watch.
But it is enjoyable to make other people watch, especially if they've never seen it before because you'll have something
to
talk about.
You're glad to have survived.
Yeah.
But you did enjoy the survival process.
Right.
It was a long walk in the high desert in the middle of
it's
summer.
It's like getting a Absolutely. Cool scar, right?
Absolutely. That's exactly it. So Box Office Mojo, this movie was number 71 for 1989. So it did better than Troop Beverly Hills.
Oh, wow.
But not as well as Pee-wee's Big Adventure. And I just wanted to share with you guys the literal translation of the foreign language titles in some of the other countries where this movie made some money. It was called Joystick Heroes in Germany, The Wizard of Video Games in Italy, Video Kid in France, The Champion of Video Games in Spain, Game Boy in Sweden.
Hey, there you go. Hey. Maybe that inspired. Yeah.
Game Over in Finland, and The Child Genius in Canada.
Child genius. Where they speak Canadian.
I feel like Canada could have figured out a different thing. Okay, so deep cut recommendations. Who has one? I have two.
So
I have three, so you guys go ahead.
Oh, jeez. We'll try to pare it down. All right.
I did three just to make sure I didn't get mine.
Because if these recommendations, if you like this movie, then you'd like
this.
I'm
only going to give one. I just wanted to make sure that I didn't.
We might be talking to a very small audience. So my deep cut recommendation is another movie that posits that what everyone loves is far more important and far more dramatic and cinematic, which is over the top and arm wrestling.
I have something.
What?
I was going to say.
The truck.
That was one of mine, too.
No,
really?
Yeah.
Well, I only had one, so it's good you guys came with multiple.
The truck that Spanky drives is the truck from Over the Top.
What?
And you can actually see on the side of that it says the name of his truckering company. Do you know what I'm talking about?
It's like
trucking or something.
Right.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, so that's my recommendation. It's far more ridiculous and slightly more entertaining.
Was that your...
I can't use that one. And then we also use anything else when we kept talking about Rain Man,
mm-hmm.
because it really is the adult version or the child version of Rain Man.
See the Oscar-winning version of this movie.
We could double down on Over the Top.
Yeah, we could double down there. That's always a good one. Can't go wrong there.
I love it.
I'm going to suggest just one, Little Miss Sunshine. I think that is this movie done right. It is a dysfunctional family road trip movie where it's both funny and serious and does both well. Mm-hmm. And I guess partially because as I was watching this movie, I was thinking of far better movies I could be watching instead. And so I think,
I'm sorry.
But yeah, that would be my recommendation.
That's a good one. I like that. So I want to recommend a TV show called The Grinder, which is Fred Savage as an actual adult, not the little adult he always was. But he is a lawyer. The premise of the show is that he's a lawyer in real life, and his brother is Rob Lowe, who's been playing a lawyer on TV for many, 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 many years. Yeah. His show gets canceled, and he moves back and tries to help his actual lawyer brother do actual law by applying his television. Yeah. And it only got one season, and then it got canceled, but I loved it, and I feel like maybe if we all watch it,
maybe it'll come back. Let's watch it right now, guys.
It wasn't that bad. I have seen The Grinder, so yeah. All right. It is one to watch if you want something to do.
And if you hate it, I'll apologize to Craig again. and then... want to recommend going to Cabazon, California, and seeing the dinosaurs that are there, which you cannot go inside. But it's a whole dinosaur park and museum now that has a Ruby's Diner not far from it. And it's a decent place to stop on your way to Universal Studios.
To beautiful Universal Studios.
Yes. So where can people find you, Erica, if they want to see some of your work?
On September 17th at 8 o'clock on Fox, we'll be airing the Manson Lost Tapes. So I'm in that, and I played Rosemary LaBianca, one of Charles Manson's victims. So we'll see what happens. I might literally end up on the cutting room floor, no puns intended there, because unfortunately her history is rather dark. But outside of that, you can find me on Twitter at ErikaConnell3. Why you ask three? Maybe just because I forgot the passwords for one and two. So that's where you can find me.
Yay! Awesome. And Craig Michael Curtis is what people look for to find you.
Craig Michael Curtis is my author's name. And you can also find me on Facebook.
Very good.
Under the same name.
And there are books that they can read of yours.
Oh, yes, I've written books.
Go buy them and read them.
They are a mystery. You have to find them and hunt them down. Like a child bounty hunter.
And, of course,
Squishy Studios. I'm on the Facebooks and the interwebs and the Twitters under Squishy Studios. And then our Voyage Trekkers sci-fi comedy half-hour pilot is still doing film festivals. And you can check out our website, voyagetrekkers.com, and see if it's playing near you.
Very cool. As always, you can find me at nctphoenix.com on the interwebs and nctphoenix, the place in real life if you're a local in Arizona. And you can find Most Excellent Pod everywhere you find pods. We're on Instagram, Facebook, all that fun stuff. What do we got coming up next? Another movie from 1989, which we referenced a whole bunch in this movie, Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Ooh, I'm excited.
We have a guest who is an actor that Nathan has worked with. It's going to be a really fun episode. So check it out. Thank you for listening. Please join us again and keep the Most Excellent Podcast motto in mind. Be excellent to each other and...
Love the power glove.
It's so bad.
Yay. Thanks, guys.